I have been using iTerm as my terminal on Mac for quite a long time. I think it's been almost 5 or 6 years I use iTerm. Let's see here on the screen, I have a command which is running a .NET run and it takes two parameters as strings and I want to change maybe one or both of them. Let's say I want to change this fix 4K video parameter name. I double click inside the parenthesis or double quotes and I want to delete it. When I press the backspace or delete key, nothing happens. Ideally, I would have liked this to be cleared like a normal text editor and I should be able to override this value. So if I want to change this, then I have to go and delete all the characters one by one and then I can say another thing like multi style video. Same way, if I have to change the other parameter and if I double click and I press the backspace key, it goes all the way to the end of the line. I would have liked this to just change the parameter where I had selected. These are some of the limitations of working with terminals where they don't behave exactly the same way like a normal text editor behaves. Other thing that I commonly do is to use these shortcut keys like the option and the back key. If I press that combination, ideally in a text editor, the cursor moves one word to the left or one word to the right. Whereas in case of terminal, it prints these special characters. I don't even know what it means. So when I work with terminal, sometimes I press these normal keyboard shortcuts and we see that it is behaving all weird way. It would be good if we have a terminal which behaves the same way like a normal text editor, and that is the topic for today's video. We are going to see a terminal called as warp terminal, which is like a terminal emulator, and currently this works only with Mac operating system. They are building this similar capabilities for other operating systems, but let's see how does this help us to get better, how does this terminal help us to be more productive, and how does it address some of these limitations. This is written in completely new language, which is Rust, or recent language in Rust, and it has many of these features which allows developers to be more effective, be more productive. So let's look at our first use case where I was trying to replace text with something different. Now I select this text in the double quotes and I press backspace and that whole text is deleted. So if I now type something different here, then it works as expected in a normal text editor. Same way, if I go onto the other double quoted string here and I change it to, let's say, Nilesh-test, I'm able to do that very effortlessly. So this is the first benefit of using this warp terminal, where you can do these inline edits, especially when you are running big commands. Let's say you are running a command which takes about 5 or 6 different parameters and you're trying to modify some of these. This can be really, really handy. The other thing is to use these normal keyboard shortcuts like command, then forward and backward, or command next and previous. It will take you to the beginning or end of the line. And then if I press the option button and then left, it moves the cursor like a normal text editor. So this input part in the warp terminal is really like a normal text input. And you can get a lot of benefits by just shifting from iTerm to warp by using these capabilities. But that's just the tip of the iceberg. The terminal has got a lot of capabilities, new capabilities, I would say. And if we go into the settings, we see that it gives us options to change the appearance of this particular terminal. The first thing is where we want to place this input box, or where we want the next command to be typed. There are three options provided. The one that I've selected is pinned to the top and reverse mode, which means that every time I type a command, it would always be at the top of the screen. So let's look at this. Let me just close this command and run a simple command like ls, we see that the output is shown below, but the cursor comes back to the top of the screen. I do have what we call as a prompt here, and I'll come to that a little later. But the benefit of this is I don't have to keep scrolling every now and then. The output keeps piling up at the bottom. So if I say ls and then hyphen hyphen tree, I get the output of the tree command here. And then we also have the option of clicking onto this as part of what they call as the segments. So when I click on the one of the segment, it is limiting to the command that was run earlier. And like this, I can clearly identify using the up and down arrow of the keyboard, which were the different commands and what was the output related to that command. Now I come back to the settings portion. And if we look at the other option here, that was the pin to top in the reverse direction. The classic mode, which the normal terminal works, is to start at the top. So if I say clear here and then I do the ls command, this is how a normal terminal behaves. In most cases, the output would be at the top and you get the input or the cursor following that output. If I want to change the other option, which is the default one in case of warp, it is to put this input box at the bottom. So you always get the output at the top and the input bar is always at the bottom. Somehow I don't prefer this option. That is why I changed this or updated the appearance to look at the third option, to have the input always at the top and output to follow below. The other thing is about the prompt. Now, if you look at what is the information shown just above the cursor here, you see this text, which is what I keep saying at the end of my videos, that code with passion and strive for excellence. I've put that on my terminal. Then on the next line, we have things like what is the operating system, the folder which I'm currently operating in. It also shows some Git related information if I'm working with a Git repository, like I'm working on main branch here. And if I made any changes, then it would also show those change files and things like that. And then we also have on the right some other prompt related things, some other prompts or some other information. This kind of prompt is the custom prompt, what we also can see on the iTerm. This comes from a project. So if you want this same prompt, you can head over to this GitHub repository called Power Level 10K. And this contains a whole lot of information about how to customize your shell or how to customize your prompt to have this colorful prompt instead of just relying on a very empty blank terminal. You can enhance the experience, and there are a lot of capabilities in this prompt. I've configured it or I've customized it as per my needs. And those things that you can see on the prompt as different segments, they can be commented or uncommented in this file, which is used to configure the PK10. There is also a configuration wizard which comes. So when you install this or when you download the GitHub repository, you can start by running this command which says PK10 configure, and the default configuration or the visual representation would be shown to you how the prompt would look. You can customize based on your needs, and then you can use this particular file, the dot file, which is used by the PK10 to configure its segments. So we can see various things like Anaconda related things, Python, Go, Node, the versions like Java version, then .NET version, PHP, all these different programming languages. It can also contain things like Kubernetes related things, the kube context, Terraform related things, AWS, cloud related, Azure related things, GCP related. So you can really go way above the normal terminal, and you can express your creativity by including these different segments or different prompt elements. And I'm also showing the load on the disk, the RAM, and the disk usage. So to just get this, sometimes when I change the settings, I don't get all this. So we can use this source command to get this from Z shell, and then we can see here these additional things like the percentage of disk use, the available RAM here, and that kind of information is added to this prompt on the right hand side. So that's about the customization of the prompt. You can very well do this in the iTerm as well. So iTerm also, I have the same configuration or the same powerline 10k customized or configured. So I have that similar look and feel. So although I changed the terminal, I don't feel too much different here. Along with this, the various other things that I can change for the prompt is, or for the terminal is, I can define all these things like the blocks, whether I want to see the compact mode or jump to the bottom or top, what font I want to use, that can be customized. There is also the option to change the theme. And the good part about changing the theme is it shows you in real time when you apply the theme how your terminal is going to look. I have the dark theme currently enabled, or I was having dark theme enabled initially. Let's say I want to use this jellyfish. So you will get a transparent background with jellyfish, and the look and feel would be customized based on the settings for this particular theme. So that's another advantage, or that's how you can customize this theme, the color theme, based on your preference. Then there are keyboard shortcuts. You can customize these. The VAR terminal comes with its default keyboard shortcuts, but if you prefer to override any of these, you can again customize them based on your needs. Another thing which is very handy here is the support for tabs. So I can have a multi-tabbed interface here, and instead of splitting or instead of opening multiple windows, I can have the same terminal but multiple tabs inside the terminal. The last feature I want to show is the AI capabilities. Nowadays it's very unlikely that new features or new products, they don't support AI. AI has become so much of a buzzword that we hear it everywhere, and VARP is not an exception to that. It supports AI in terms of its capabilities. So we can just type hash here, and then there is this little indicator which comes up saying ask VARP AI, and I can click here and it will give me like a prompt similar to ChatGPT. And I can type my question here. I can say, give me the command to sort files based on creation time. So let's say I want to run this command, or I don't know what is the command used for sorting this. And VARP AI will tell me that ls is the command, and we can pass hyphen lt as the flag. Now if I want to execute this command, I can click on this small icon here and it transfers that to the actual terminal, and I can run that particular command inside. Apart from this, it also has a couple of other handy features that I've tried so far. Let's say I'm working with git or any other commands, it will automatically give autocompletion for us. So I can start to type commands like this, git add, for example. I want to add a file, and automatically it will give suggestions on the terminal itself, and then based on the context it will start changing. I can also see the different flags like all, chmod, dry run, edit, these kind of supported flags for this git add command. And I can go and select this and then execute the command. It also has the command feature where it can highlight. So let's say I typed a wrong command, git add for example, it will highlight that this command is not the correct command, which is again very handy when you're working with terminals, and I find this very, very useful. The last part, or the last thing which I've tried here is, let's say I want to get auto suggestion based on the history of the commands I've run. So I can get these here, and if I'm interested, I can just press the tab key or the next key here on the keyboard, and that particular command would be selected. So those are some of the very handy features which I found useful in this terminal. And since this is new, I assume that we would get new features added as this terminal capabilities keeps on improving in future. With that, we come to the end of this video. I hope you found this useful. In case you like the video, please hit the like button and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. If you want to get notifications when the videos are published, please hit that bell button or bell icon. And do let me know in the comments how you found this video, and if there is anything specific you would like me to cover on this channel. Until next time, code with passion and strive for excellence.